Hey guys, it's so great that you guys came to our small group night. I'm glad that you're joining us wherever your small group is meeting. I've got one quick announcement for you guys before you head off into the video. That is that YouthQuake is coming up and we only have so many spots, so you want to register now. So if you have questions about that, you can ask your leader and your leader might get you in touch with me, but you should register as soon as possible for this trip. You don't want to miss out. All right, I'm gonna pass you guys off to both myself and Jared as we lead you guys through your small group time video.
Hey everyone, glad you could join us for small group night tonight. You got Levi and I giving you the little message today, but yeah.
Cool, so like to begin, what's something unimportant that you can't stand, Jared?
Oh, I hate the sound of chewing.
Oh my goodness, me too.
It's terrible. I mean, like when somebody has got their mouth open when they're chewing, I just want to punch the food right out of their face. I mean, oh.
For me, it's like more about the sound. Like when, I don't know, have you ever watched those videos on YouTube where it's like someone eating something? And I think that's like,
yeah.
People like that kind of thing, which is weird.
Oh.
But like the sound of like the, oh. I can't handle that sound.
Like it's literally something that takes me from like being completely calm to absolutely infuriated the moment I hear it.
It's terrible.
It's the worst.
Okay, so question for you guys in your small group. What's something that you guys just can't stand? Like it can be something unimportant. It can be something important too, but what's something that you can't stand?
Okay, maybe you didn't agree with everything that everybody said, but you have to admit, it's kind of fun to gang up on some things that we hate. When someone calls us out, or calls something out, I should say, we often feel like just joining in and piling on, even when it's something dumb, just like pineapple on pizza or chewing with your mouth closed. But Levi, have you ever noticed how easy it is for us to just gang up on something or on other people?
Yeah, I think like sometimes it seems like we're just waiting for someone to make a mistake so that we can all gang up on them. Or like if one person has some bad emotions, maybe they're sad, angry, or just mean, like it doesn't take long for a whole group of people to gang up. And I think they call that like mob mentality. And actually that makes me think of this clip.
Not safe till his head is mounted on my wall. I say we kill the beast.
Not safe until he's dead.
He'll come stalking us at night.
Set to sacrifice our children to his monstrous appetite.
He'll wreak havoc on our village if we let him wander free.
So it's time to take some action, boys. It's time to follow me.
The mist, through the woods, through the darkness and the shadows. It's a nightmare, but it's one exciting ride. Say a prayer, then we're there at the drawbridge of a castle, and there's something truly terrible inside. It's a beast. He's got fangs, razor sharp ones, massive paws, killer claws for the feast. Hear him roar, see him foam, but we're not coming home till he's dead. Good and dead! Kill the beast!
No, I won't let you do this.
If you're not with us, you're against us.
You've probably never joined a crazy mob with pitchforks and like torches and stuff like that, but I'm guessing that you've probably ganged up on someone before, or you and like a group of people have ganged up on someone before. Don't get me wrong, sometimes it's actually okay to be calling someone out, especially if they've done something that's really bad. Like right now there's stuff in the news about the whole like movement of women rising up and calling out men who have done some terrible things. Like those are good things to be doing for the public to be gathering around and calling people out. But that's different than ganging up on someone.
Yeah, totally. I think the glee so many of us get from ganging up on other people, especially when somebody's already been knocked down, might show us a little something important about ourselves. I think God has designed us to be in relationships with each other, but instead of coming together in healthy relationships and good relationships, we often come together in judgment and hatred of others, and that's absolutely not what God intended at all.
So far in the series, we've been talking about hurt and pain, and I think this week that what we want to talk about is What do we do when others are hurting? Mm-hmm. I think it's easy to gang up on someone, but when someone's in pain or has made a big mistake, what might it look like for us to gather around them in a different way? And so I actually have a story. One of our youth leaders is going to share it, and it's about how her community came together. So here is Tessa. She's going to be sharing her story.
Hey guys, I'm here to tell you a story of when my community made me stronger. So right after high school, I went to Columbia Bible College in Abbotsford, BC. Some of you may know it. It's a super rad place. It was probably one of the best years of my life. And one of the best things that I did when I was there was get plugged into community, not only at the school, but in a church as well. And I got plugged into a church called South Abbey Church, and I served in kids ministry there. I led Sunday school and also got involved in youth ministry. And that was an amazing experience for me. I loved it so much that after I graduated from CBC, I stayed to do a children's ministry internship over the summer. And that was an amazing experience for me. I got plugged in with the greater church community as well as the youth community there. And I made so many lasting friendships, and the church just felt like my home. And that's really what made Abbotsford feel like home for me as well. And then the fall after I came back to Lethbridge to start university here, there was a tragedy that happened at Abbotsford, and two of my youth girls were involved in a school stabbing, killing one of them. And that was really hard, especially being in Lethbridge and removed from the community in Abbotsford again. But the community that I had built was so strong that that's what really pulled me through. And I could feel their love coming all the way from Abbotsford to Lethbridge. So if only I were in Abbotsford, it would have been amazing how strong that community was. And it was really cool to see how the church banded together in that time and supported each other. There was always someone to talk to or to cry with. There's always someone cooking meals and supporting you if you needed. And even other churches in Abbotsford came together, and it was a really neat experience to see how the church body could be unified in a time of hardship. And the entire city just became one, and all the churches, there was no division between anyone. And it became a struggle for everyone to go through together, but to be supported by everyone. And if it weren't for that community, even being so far removed, for I don't think I would have come through the way that I did. I felt so loved and supported, and I feel like that experience brought a lot of people closer to Jesus, and it brought me closer to Jesus. And never once did I doubt his plan or where he was going, what he was doing, because I just knew through other people as well that that he was doing something good, and that he would make this situation into something beautiful, and he did. And I think community was the best part of that.
So the Bible actually talks about this in Romans 5, 2 to 5. So why don't you guys as a small group read that together right now? Romans 5, 2 to 5.
Okay, so in this passage, Paul says that we can rejoice in our pain. Rejoice in our pain. That seems a little weird, doesn't it? I mean, nobody throws a party when they fail a test or like get messed up or heartbroken or make a big mistake. Nobody does that. I don't know when the last time I don't know if I've ever heard of anybody doing that. But Paul says we have a legitimate reason to find joy in our pain. We rejoice because loss and failure actually produces perseverance and character over time. But let's face it, no matter what, have you ever tried to be happy about your own pain and suffering? It's absolutely not easy.
Okay, let me remind you though that this passage isn't just directed at one person. It was written to a whole community. It's written to the Romans. And so Paul, when he's writing this letter, he's assuming that this letter is going to be read by a whole community. It's going to be read by the church. It's going to be read by the people gathering together, a group of people. And if we want to understand what Paul is trying to get across, we have to understand that context that it's been written in. So with that in mind, a few pages later in the book of Romans, we actually see Paul continuing this conversation about caring for others and being there with them. So why don't you guys read together Romans 12, 9 to 21. This is a continuation of what Paul was already trying to communicate to the Romans. So Romans 12, 9 to 21. Again, Paul tells us to rejoice in our suffering, but this time it's in the middle of the passage, surrounded by how we can love each other. And I don't think that's an accident. I think Paul really wants us to understand that he's writing to a group of people and about a community and how we are, how we should be committed to loving each other and caring for each other. Paul knew something we need to remember. That's when life goes wrong, God gives us each other. So when someone or something hurtful it happens to us, God gives us each other. When we're going through pain and hurt, God gives us each other. When we make huge mistakes in our lives, God gives us each other.
He totally does. When someone in our lives is hurting or grieving or experiencing a big failure, how will we respond? Will we ignore them? Will we just pile on anger and judgment? Or will we gather around them in love? And if we do decide to gather around them in love, what should that even look like? How do we know, first of all, when someone is hurting? And then after that, what should we do about it? There's a video clip that we're going to play now that hopefully helps us understand this a little bit.
Alongside such unforgettable home runs, the setting for this one was a bit different. In a small town in the middle of Washington State, on a field inside a chain-linked fence, in a game fewer than 100 people saw. A home run memorable not for the distance it traveled or the game it decided, but for the meaning it carried. The last Saturday in April, the second game of a softball doubleheader between Central Washington and Western Oregon.
Well, we were both neck and neck fighting for the conference championship.
As a senior, this was Sarah Tukolsky's last chance to win a championship. She'd never hit a home run before, not in college, not in her life.
A 5'2", I'm not very tall. I'm more a line drive hitter. I don't hit for power.
But in the top of the second inning, with two runners on the second pitch, that changed.
I hit that pitch and it just went.
And we're just cheering, and the runners are cheering as they round the base to head to home. And then I'm going, where's Sarah?
In her excitement, Tukolsky failed to touch first base, so she quickly turned back.
Her pivoting leg just didn't pivot with her. And I heard her kind of yell, and she just dropped to the ground, and I was like, oh no. Just fell immediately and was in a lot of pain. Just, you know, I tried to keep my leg straight, but I was in so much pain that I couldn't really keep still.
Tukolsky, with a torn ACL, crawled back to first base. She was a long way from reaching home plate and keeping her first and only home run.
When she got back to first base, she laid there and she hugged on to first base. And then I was staring at the base and I go, what on earth are we gonna do?
And I turned the umpire standing right next to me. I said, what is the ruling if I put somebody in for Sarah? He said, it'll be a 2-run single.
If anybody would have on her team would have helped Sarah, she would have been called out.
That was the problem. None of Tukolsky's teammates were allowed to touch her. That's when Central Washington's Mallory Holtman, a player with more home runs than any other in conference history, a player for the opposing team, spoke up.
I went to the home plate umpire and asked if we could pick her up and carry her, and he looked at me a little strange.
And the umpire went and said, yes, you can do that. I'm still standing there in shock. I said, thank you so much.
We asked her, so like, is it okay if we pick you up and carry you around the bases?
And I say yes, and you know, and say thank you. And she says, you hit the ball over the fence, you deserve it.
For that reason only, because she deserved it, Holtman and Wallace began to carry the injured Tucholsky, stopping to touch her left foot on each base as the three made their way around the diamond.
We actually started laughing because we were just wondering what this would look like to all the people in the stands.
When I looked up, I didn't see, you know, giant like smiles and screams. I saw emotion and tears and people crying.
It's a great moment when someone has character to step up and do the right thing at the right time.
It's emotional. You're proud. Be associated with those kids.
That's the first home run of the season for number 8, Sarah Tucholsky.
The fact is, you know, I made my goal. I hit a home run, and yeah, it's my last at bat of my career, but I, you know, made my goal, so I'm proud of myself.
Mallory Holtman, Liz Wallace, and the Central Washington team lost the game that day, 4-2. Sarah Tucholsky lost the rest of her season and her career to a knee injury. But for the spirit of sportsmanship, a greater victory made on a long trot around the bases, a trip that truly touched them all.
I have a lot of respect for her and put her in high regards, her and her teammates. And, you know, I can't thank her enough.
Okay, Sarah's injury was super painful and unexpected. And I mean, she probably felt angry with herself and frustrated at the situation, embarrassed even, at the way things would have happened during this injury. But do you see what her opponents did? Their actions reflected so much of the words that Paul wrote to the Romans. And so when they saw Sarah's pain and her failure and her loss, they didn't just pretend to care. They really cared. They honored her. They practiced enthusiasm, joy, hope, and patience with her. They celebrated in her victory, and they even mourned in her pain. They weren't too proud to help her, and they refused to see her as an enemy to be hated and ignored. They saw her as a person, a real person to be loved.
Yeah, every time we see someone fail or go through pain, we have this opportunity to gather around them and pick them up and finish the game. And when we do that, we all win together. We all grow stronger together. We all build character together. We all model hope, joy, and selfless love to the world around us together. Did you hear what these girls said about the reaction of the crowd? They were like inspired and moved by what had happened. Maybe it's because deep down we know that we're designed to live life together. Before we leave today, I want to practice something that we've been going through as a youth group recently, and that's praying for each other, gathering around those who are hurting.
Mm-hmm. I know life gets difficult a lot of the time, and more often than not, for both us and for those around us. And when it does, I hope that you'll remember, when life goes wrong, God gives us each other. And so I'm going to close in prayer here in a minute, but like Levi said, after this video is over, I want you guys to take some time in your small groups and maybe break off into pairs to actually just pray for each other. If somebody's going through hurt and pain, gather around that person and let's pray for that person. Let's pray on their behalf. So I'll pray, and then you guys can head off to that. Father in heaven, thank you so much for giving us each other. that you've given us a community that can come around us, Father, and that you've showed us that this is your way, Father. When times get hard and we just want to jump on the bandwagon and hate on people and break down relationships like that, God, I pray that you'd remind us that you've called us to be in community with each other and to actually come around and support each other and pray for each other and honor you in doing that. Father, be with us today as we finish off small groups and the rest of our week. We love you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.